You are my love. Bearing all my sin and shame. Thank you. Come on, bow to God and God. up on the press of the ones that are in the name of Jesus.
I'm Would you tell them, give somebody a good hug and say thank you so for bringing to me today? Praise God. God bless you. God bless you. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Welcome, welcome. Welcome to Destiny Life Center International Boston. Thank you, Jesus. Some of you guys straight over your hand. Amen. Amen. But, you know, our eyes have not yet seen. Our ears have not yet heard. Said to me, we have not seen the being. We have not begun to scratch the surface. So truly, it has not entered our hearts as yet. The things, Boston belong to Jesus. Amen. Amen. I really believe that God has spectacular things for all of us to do. That's why. You know, there's a word that's lacking in our theme. You know, it says that we are called Destiny Life Center International. But I'm going to put another word in there. I want you to know that that's the real name of our church. It's called Destiny Life Work Church. It means that if you are a part of this body, we believe that you can do something. I don't even believe it, but I do. I believe every member of the human body is to be functional. I believe that every organ in my body is supposed to be active. I have no part in my body that's dead. Every part of my body is alive. And Paul described the church as the body of Christ. That means that every part of his body is alive. I know you don't believe it, but I'm going to remind you today that you're not dead. And because you're not dead, there is something that you can do. Touch your neighbor and say, there is something you can do. Come on. And the church needs you. So let's run today. We're going to open the church doors and strength for those who want to be part of what God has called us to do here at Destiny. And those who desire to be part of us, you can come and join. But for now, my wife and my class, ask my wife to come and stand by me. My wife and I just want to welcome you to Destiny Life Center International Boston. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. This is my wife. My wife, the Lord has blessed my wife and I in 38 years. This year, 2017, has been the most trying year for my wife and me. In all the many years that we've been married, much trying, but in spite of what trials may come our way, I believe. Yeah. Hallelujah. And I'm going to sing Hosanna in the highest. Yeah. So I thank God for on behalf of my wife and me, on behalf of my wife, amen. We welcome you to be part of this great worship experience. Of course, you did not come to see me or her. You've come to receive a word from the Father. That's why you're here. We welcome you today. So you want to take this time to welcome you. If you are watching with us today for the very first time, can you just kind of stand and just see who you are? Come on, Destiny. Come on, Destiny. Hold on, hold on. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. You may stand. You may stand. You may stand. Business, we love people. We go all out for people. That's who I am. As a matter of fact, someone gave me a plaque one time that says the people's pastor. I'm not quite sure what that means. But, you know, I really believe that that's why Christ came on this earth. He came on this earth not for trees and for cats and dogs, even though people believe that Christ came for cats and dogs. I remember the base that I must share with you. There was once my wife and I went to a store, and there was a person, the attendant behind the counter, was crying, very emotional. And so my wife said to her, "Oh, is something wrong?" And she said, "Yes." And I said, my wife, of course, being my wife, a woman, she says, "What's wrong?" She says, "I lost my cat." And then the wife says, you can't die. And I thought, honey, come on. That's cool. She thought that all dogs go to heaven. But may I say to you that Jesus came and he said to you and I. He said, people, Jesus is going to be celebrated. But it's called Easter Sunday, it's Resurrection Sunday. But we thank God for you coming up this morning and just being a part of this glorious worship experience. Amen. Praise God. You know, we here at Destiny, we love to pray for folks, for you in the heart. Our church is called a house of prayer for all people. So amongst those of you that are right next to these old guests, just stretch your hands. Maybe lay down on them and so forth. I don't know why I don't do it with a prayer over here at this time. Praise God.
Thank you, Lord. Father, we praise you this morning. We thank you for being here, O God. Father, I thank you, O God, for every visitor, O God, that you are the one that assigned them to be here. Because you have something special. They are not here by accident, O God. I pray, O God, as your word comes forth, O God, it will penetrate their heart and they will never be the same. You are the one that orchestrated the time, oh God, that they should come and hear your word be ministered to their heart. Father, bless them, oh God. Protect them, oh God, from the hands and the plan that the enemy has set for them. I take dominion over the works of darkness right now. I bind sickness from their bodies and I speak wholeness. I speak long life. God, I thank you for having your way. Bless them in Jesus' name.
Thank you so much for coming here. Have you sit back, relax, get something to write with, something to write on, for truly believe that the Father has a specific word for you today. Amen. Once again, put your hands in for these old guests that's going to win. Praise God. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Destiny Life Center, it's time to sow. This is good sow, good ground. Yes. We sow, we expect to reap a harvest. That's why we're still sowing and we're not giving, because when we sow as a farmer, we expect to see something from our seeds. So today we're going to sow our seeds in this good soil and expect to reap a harvest.
Amen.
We take your offerings and hold them in the hand of your strength. The God has brought safely through 1 week and we have the start of another week. Yes. So it's only good to give him the goodness, the greatness, the mercies, and the love that he deserves. Amen. So all your offerings in the hands of your strength. Yes. May God check out your Destiny Life Center International. All the letters DLCI.
Yes.
Oh, there's another one coming, another way to give as well. Those of you that are computer savvy, internet savvy, www.destinylifecenter.church, and you can give online as well. Yes. So if you're not going to be here for Sunday, whatever the case may be, you can still sow your seeds. Let us pray. Father, we thank you and we praise you for your goodness, your greatness, your mercies, and your love towards us. We thank you, Lord, how you have brought us safely through a past week and into the beginning of another week. We thank you for our strength, O God. We thank you that goodness and mercy shall follow us all the days of our lives. And so, Father, this morning, we want to sow a seed into this ministry. And we expect to reap a harvest according to your word. You said, Lord God, to give good measure, pressed down, shake it together, and run it over. Lord God, and you will return it unto us. You said to bring all the tithes and offerings into your house, that they may meet in your house. Prove you, Lord God, that you will not open up the windows of heaven and pour the blessing unto us. So, Father, we pray that you will return to your people today that which they have sown. We pray, Lord God, that there will be no lack in their lives. Whether it be finances, Lord God, whether it be relationships, whatever the case, Lord God, we pray that there will be no lack. And we come against the enemy, Lord God, recognizing that he might try to bring poverty to your people. But we stand upon your word this morning, knowing that you are God, knowing that you are Lord. And we thank you for your blessings. We thank you for your love. In Jesus' name.
Praise the Lord. Let's stand and rejoice as we give this morning. Oh,
Praise the Lord. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Thank you, Jesus.
Praise God. Can you hear me back there?
Yes.
Oh, can you hear me back there?
Yes.
Amen. Praise the Lord.
I didn't ask anyone to sit.
You're going to be seated for a while. Amen. Praise God. Praise God.
Thank you, Lord.
Put your hands together for the worship leaders and the worship team. And praise God for them this morning. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. I just said, will you kindly turn to the book of 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, please. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. Paul's letter to the church in Thessalonica. Reading from the New International Version. I'm not sure, maybe there was maybe on the screen, or if you have some type of electrical device, then of course you can follow along. And those of you who have children and like to have your children go to the Sunday school, we have a place back here for children, and be well taught by some capable and credible individuals. Amen. 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 Leave it in the safety of our children. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
So these are little doctors and little lawyers and little preachers. Amen. 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 Let me ask God for these. Amen. God bless them. God bless them. Amen. We thank God for Sister Jewel and the staff that is working diligently with our children back there. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, reading from verse 4. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, reading from verse 4. But you, brothers, and I say sisters here also, brothers and sisters, are not in darkness, so that this day should surprise you like a thief. You are all sons of the light and sons of the day. We do not belong to the night or to the darkness. So then, let us not be like others who are asleep, but let us be alert and self-controlled. For those who sleep, sleep at night. And those who get drunk at night. But since we belong to the day, let us be self-controlled, putting on faith and love as... Talk to me, somebody. Putting on faith and love as breastplate, and the hope of salvation as
helmet.
For God did not appoint us to suffer wrath, but to receive salvation through our Lord Jesus the Christ. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, how thankful we are for another moment like this, that we can sit together like Mary, who sat at the feet of Jesus. And we cry like Samuel, speak, Lord, a word that is able to transform us today. We bind the enemy that will try to distract or rob us from this word. And Holy Spirit, we give you permission to search our hearts and to circumcise our hearts, Lord, so that we can apply the truth of your word to our hearts and to our lives, so that we can be the type of warriors you call us to be. In Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise God. Praise God. God bless you. Take your seats, please. Praise God. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. So, for some time, we started this journey along this road as the Lord has said through the Apostle Paul that we need to put on the full armor of God. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10, all the way to verse 18. That we as Christians need to put on the full armor of God. It's amazing that he did not say just put on the armor, but to put on the full armor of God, which tells us that there are times that a believer can put on a part or a portion of the armor, leaving other parts of our bodies exposed to the flaming arrows of the enemy. And for some time we began our journey, we covered the various parts of this armor, as we spoke about the breastplate of righteousness. We spoke about the girdle of truth. We spoke about having our feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. And today we decide to look at a very important piece of the armor that's called a helmet. The helmet. Yeah. You know, sometime, I think it was in 2009, there was a young man around 36 years old that was riding one of these skateboards. He rode a skateboard as he was riding. But he told himself that he could ride without a helmet. And somehow he collided and developed a fracture in his skull that caused him to lose his life at 36 years old. And the papers in Michigan also gave another story. That was a young girl, she was 11 years old, who was doing the very same thing, riding a skateboard. The difference between that young girl and this fellow is that her parents made sure she had on her helmet. And while she was riding a skateboard, she collapsed, she fell in the middle of the road. And there comes a car. And the car rolled over her elbow and over her head. Rolled right over. And the paper says her life was spared because she had on a helmet. And the paper says how sad it is for people to believe that they can ride these roller skateboards without a helmet. It shows us how important the helmet is. Now, in some of the states in the Union, it's not required that you should wear a helmet if you ride in a motorcycle or one of these vehicles out there. But in this Commonwealth, in Massachusetts, it is required by law, if I'm not mistaken, Pastor Jones, that if you're going to ride a motorcycle or even a bicycle, that you should wear a helmet. Now, my wife and I have just become parents again. And one of my grandsons believes that his head is high, so he does not need a helmet. So we must be forceful enough. And young man, even though you may believe that you can break the law of the land by not wearing a helmet, I do not want to pick you up and rush you to the hospital because you decide to disobey the law of the land by not wearing a helmet. So it tells me that a helmet is very important for us to wear. Truly amazing that the Apostle Paul did not just speak about the helmet, but he spoke about the kind of helmet. Because in those olden days, there are various kinds of helmets that these soldiers would wear. Some of the helmets that some of these men would wear would be very, it has very various decorations of on the helmets that shows the rank that the officers held. But the average soldier would just have a helmet that was designed for battle. The helmet that the Apostle Paul is speaking about is a helmet not because to show the rank that you are in, but to say if you have that helmet on, you are ready for warfare. Now the Apostle Paul said it so clearly in the sermon for Peter, said that we need to be alert and self-controlled. These are military words. Alert and self-controlled because our enemy, not just the enemy, but our enemy, which tells me that we have an enemy that is aggressively after us. And he will do everything in his power to make sure we forget to put on our helmet. So as we leave our helmet at home or somewhere on the shelf, that we can ride and only waiting for an accident to happen, where his desire is to steal, kill, and totally destroy us. Paul is saying, put on this helmet. And of course, the church in Thessalonica, he took the time to explain this type of helmet. So not only is he speaking to the church in Ephesus, but he's speaking to the church in Thessalonica that we need to put on this helmet that is called salvation. It's not just a helmet, but he says the helmet of salvation. And to the church in Thessalonica, he says that salvation, that we take on salvation as a helmet. No. The helmet protects where? Our head. Our minds. Covers us, protects us. And the flaming darts that the enemy is throwing at us are thoughts that cause us to doubt God.
Yes.
Do you really believe that you are who God says you are? You may remember there in Genesis chapter 3 that the enemy came before our four parents, Mama, Eve, and Papa Adam. Maybe he's not yours, but he's mine. Amen. He came before them and said to them, have God said? He placed inside of their minds a thought to doubt God. We must be careful that the enemy don't place thoughts. Even believers. I'm not talking to the folks out there. Because he got them. But for those of us that are saved, it's very easy for him to place thoughts in our minds.
Yes.
I was employed as a manager of quality control for a company for many years. And when they asked me to come into the offices, they sent me off to learn certain skills and so forth. And they said to me, "Coop, I want you to oversee this area, this department." And I said, "Fine." And for 1 month, I sat there in that company waiting for someone to come to show me the do's and don'ts. And the person never showed up. By the end of the duration time, the company, the customer service personnel manager sent a message, called me to the office and says that the operations manager says, "I am not qualified for that office." They never saw me in the training. They never came in to see what I did. But they just assumed that I wasn't qualified. So I said, "Okay." And then, well, what made this person, I said, "I would like to know, how did this person evaluate me?
Yeah.
Show me the evaluation process so I can be satisfied that I'm not qualified." Well, don't get upset. But you see, you guys are saved. I'm Holy Ghost filled and try baptized. Every now and then I move in the flesh. Every now and then I just ease over in the flesh. So of course, when I said, so she said to me, "Don't get upset, don't get annoyed, Roland, don't get upset. Do me a favor, take this form and go home and fill it out. Fill it out and bring it back to me to show me that you're qualified." So I took the form and I brought it home. And of course, talked to my wife about it. And my wife, of course, said, "Let's pray about it." "Yes, no problem. Let's pray about it." But my wife said, "Before we pray over this form, let us anoint the form with oil." So I said, "Anoint the form with oil. To take back to that person." Then my wife thinks this is a church. The mere fact I brought back a piece of greasy paper to this person, I know they would say, "No, I will not qualify." So I took, of course, I made my fingers, I touched the four hands, I lay on my hands, I began to pray for the thing. But I just want you to know, when I was moving towards the office, I'm moving toward the office. I could hear the old Negro spiritual well up inside of me. "Listen to me, we all hear the voice of the enemy."
Yeah.
And the song that he sung in my head was, "Nobody, nobody knows the trouble I see. Nobody knows." So I'm just singing that old pitiful song inside. And I'm hearing the voice of the enemy saying to me, "You know you're not getting that job because he wants to give it to a white man." That's not you, that's me. I'm hearing his voice in my head saying, "You know you're not getting that job. He's giving that job to somebody who is his friend." So of course, we began to pray about this thing. And in prayer, the Lord showed me it was not about them, because my fight is not against flesh and blood, but it's against some stuff that was taking place in the heavenlies.
Yeah.
And the way to defeat them, I had to defeat them on my knees.
Yes.
So I began to pray. I bind those spirits. I commanded them to loose my blessing.
Yes.
Of course, after a few days, I went back. They were not there. But at the end of the week, they called me to the office and says, "Roland, I want you to know that we are hiring 6 people on Monday morning for you to train."
Yeah.
"And I'm giving you an increase of 6%. Yeah. Listen to me. The thoughts came to my mind.
Yes, yes, yes.
I've been playing with those thoughts. It's a lie. Because the devil is the master liar. He places thoughts in our minds to doubt God. Because I want you to know, when my wife and I were praying and binding those spirits, when they called me in the office, I was still hearing the voices. "You got a wife, you got some children, you got rent, and you got all these bills to pay, and now they're getting ready to give you the pension." Why could I take that thought and say, "Lord, thank you. Hallelujah. Because you promised that goodness and mercy." Why didn't I have those thoughts? God always had a good thought there for me. But I couldn't hear the voice of God. All I heard
I'm talking to you, brothers and sisters, this morning. Because there are times when the stuff is in your face and all you're hearing is a negative voice of the devil. When my daughter passed, well, you know, now God hates you. Now, you know that you look at you now. Yeah. Let me see what you're going to do. You got to close down the church, you know. You can't preach anymore because the devil, yeah, because God, you, let me see how much you love God now. God took your child. I said, yes, devil, God may take him, devil took her. But guess what? I'm still going to serve God. Yeah. I am going to serve my God regardless of what circumstances I'm in. Rose up, Job, though he slay me. Yet will I trust. I held him for salvation. Protect my mind. Put it on, brothers and sisters, put it on. So he called it salvation. Salvation. And if you should do any study regarding that word, salvation, it always points to Exodus chapter 40. Always points that direction. And this scripture, you turn to in your research, you're going to see when you study salvation. Most of the dictionaries and the commentators, they point towards Exodus, because in Exodus chapter 14, the Lord spoke to Moses and said, Moses, I want you to stand still and see the salvation of your God. These Egyptians that you see today, can you just hear the voice of God? That problem that you're facing today, that situation, that financial burden, that relationship stuff that you're facing today, Lord is saying, those enemies that you see today, no longer. And you have to contend with them. Stand still. Don't fight. Every now and then, you want to put on the boxing gloves, right? Get into the ring. But God says, stand still and see what I can do for you.
Yes. Amen.
Salvation. Listen. That word salvation that the apostle is saying for us to put it on, and we call it the helmet. It means to be saved. It means to be delivered from something. Not just saved, but delivered from something. In this, it is the redemption of mankind from the bondage of something that has held us captive for years. Every living human being needs to be delivered from something.
Amen.
Simply because we were born in sin. And because we were born in sin, our natural tendency is to sin. It's not natural for us not to sin. You may think, well, that's good, but I've been saved for many years. But let me let you know today that as long as you are still in that body that's called the flesh, you can mess up anytime. You can mess up. You can mess up. So salvation means to be not saved, not only saved, but being what? Delivered. Come and say to me, being what?
Delivered.
So as I began to study salvation. If I need to wear salvation as a helmet, I need to know what salvation consists of. If I'm able to protect my mind from these thoughts, these flaming darts that the enemy is throwing at my mind all the time, all the time. So first of all, as I study text, it means that I need to be forgiven.
Amen.
I need to remember that I am forgiven. You know, the very first temptation that Jesus Christ was confronted with there in Matthew chapter 4 and also in Luke chapter 4, Jesus was confronted by the devil himself. The Bible says, after fasting for 40 days and 40 nights in the desert, he was hungry. And he came, Jesus Christ was confronted by Satan himself. And Satan said to Jesus, if you are the Son of God. He tried to challenge the word. Now, let me help you a little bit. The word of God is Jesus. The word became flesh. So when he said to the word, if you are the word, you see, my brothers and sisters, what I realize that this enemy does with us
is that he tried to confuse our identity.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
If I do not know who I am, I'm prone to believe that I am who you says I am.
That's right.
But who you says I am, that may not be who I am.
Amen.
So I believe what you say that I am might be quite contrary to what God says I am. So our young children today, I went to the McDonald's one day to get some fries for my grandkids, and while I'm there, I look at two young girls. They were just barely 12, maybe between 10 and 15, somewhere there, young girls. And they were right in the corner kissing. I looked at both of these young girls, and I said to myself, well, it's amazing that they're so confused. They don't know who they are. And our laws has given permission that you are free to do as you want, to express yourself. So if you feel that you are a boy and you are female, it's okay, you are a boy. It's to show you how confused our society is. Because our identity has been tainted by somebody who told us that we are not who God says we are, but who society says we are. So he came to Jesus and says, if you are the Son of God. Whereas in Matthew chapter 3, you have, after Jesus was baptized, a voice from heaven came and says, this is my son. Jesus didn't need to even answer him.
Amen.
Because he was the Word.
Amen.
He's the truth. He's the Word.
And Lord.
See. So the first thing that I must remember is that I'm forgiven.
Amen. Amen. Yes.
Roland, you have been forgiven. That means all the stuff I've done in this world, all the lies I've told, all the wrong things I've done, they all have been under the blood. Somebody give God some praise. Every wrong thing that you have done, every wrong thing that you are doing, and every wrong thing that you do in the future, they are all under the blood.
Amen.
You wash away. And then you may ask yourself the question, well, who, since that I am forgiven and all the wrong things I've ever done in this life, since I've been forgiven, I could just go on living as I want. Wrong. But the gift of God, the gift, someone said the gift. The gift of God is eternal life. I want to just do a demonstration before you today, because this is so important, and sometimes we miss the truth of what God has said to us. This iPad is mine. It's been, I think my wife bought it for me or something. We didn't steal it though, I'm not sure. But this iPad cost something. I mean, the manufacturer, Steve Jobs and all these people, he paid some people, and they all came up with this idea to design an iPad, and here is the iPad in my hand because somebody paid a price for this iPad to be in my hand today. I said, police would come and arrest me right now for stealing somebody's iPad. This iPad belongs to me. Now if Mr. Shirley should, should say, because she had done, because she's so nice to me, I decided that I'd give her this iPad. This iPad has now become a gift to Shirley. But please understand, because it's a gift to Shirley, it wasn't a gift to me.
Mm-hmm.
It cost me something.
Yes.
But to Shirley, it's free.
Mm-hmm.
Let me just go over it, please, again. The iPad that I have in my hand, this iPad cost, as a matter of fact, this one cost almost $800, that thing, very expensive. This iPad, if I'm to take this iPad and give it to Mr. Shirley, I say, Shirley, here is a gift to Shirley that is free. She's happy. Hallelujah. But to me, it costs something.
Yeah.
That means that to God, it costs God everything that God has.
Yeah.
But to us, it's free. The gift of God is eternal life. But listen to me, please. Because it is free, there are many on this earth who will die and go to hell because they have never received the gift.
Amen.
Not because of their sins. It's because of failure to receive this gift. So this gift that God has offered to us, this gift, even though their sins have been forgiven, because no human being will be judged for their sins, but you'll be judged for failure to take this gift. Well, the Lord's going to ask us, what have you done with the gift I've given to you? When are you going to be judged? What have you done with the gift I gave to you? Gift, Lord? What gift is that?
My son.
A few days ago, you remember, we celebrated Easter Sunday? What do you think that was about? Eggs? Bunny eggs? No. That was about my son. Who rose from the dead. That was my gift to you. So I must remember that I am forgiven. Must remember. Roland, I'm forgiven. Even though I may mess up again in the future, even though I may have done something wrong in the tomorrow, it still doesn't matter because I know, hallelujah, that there is a fountain that spirit blood that's drawn from Emmanuel's vein. And anybody can punch me, that's what I lose all the goodness is. I know that I can be forgiven again. You can fall, you can get right back up, and ask God, and God will forgive us again. That's his church. Listen, I have my wife and I have now become parents again. You know, so we have two children, two grandkids in my house. And you know, my wife and I now are parenting again. So in this season of my life, I'm realizing that, man, every day I got to be a referee. I mean, stop looking at me. Stop fighting at me. Give me his mind. I mean, just constant. Now, I just numb. I just take my finger and put in my head. Even if I try to pat or take one side, in a flash moment, the both of them are patting again, I become dead again.
Yes.
So therefore, I just put my finger in my head and leave them alone. Amen. I must remember that I am forgiven. Come and say to me, I am forgiven. Know for sure that you are forgiven. Amen. Another benefit that I realize that this salvation brings is that I am delivered from the bondage of sin. So sin no longer has any rights over me.
That's right.
You see, once upon a time, I was a slave. I was driven. So people use the word, the devil made me do it. It's a lie. I can imagine the devil sitting in the corner saying, why are you lying at me? That's not me. That's you. No, the devil made me do it. For those of you that are saved, Galatians chapter 6 verse 1 says like this, that if a brother is, well, the NIV and the King James Version may word a little differently, so forgive me if it doesn't sound the same in your head. But the NIV says, if a brother or sister is caught in a sin, you who are, and one version says, you are spiritual, and another version says, you who are spirit-led,
yes,
should restore such person gently.
Yes.
But watch yourself. Because you can also be tempted. Which tells me, it really should be written like this. If a person, man or woman, should be overtaken in a weakness. If I should, let's say for instance, I was a gambler. You know, time I get my check, I'm headed to Foxwood. I don't know, over there somewhere. I don't know, where you're a gambler. And then I'm saved now, and I'm living for God. And one week, one month, things are tight. And I thought, man, I dreamt the number last night. I mean, 5, 4, 2, 7. So, listen, I got to go somewhere. Where are you going? I can't tell you. I just got to make a run. So I'm headed to Foxwood to gamble. And when I get there, I lost every dime. I come home. And because I lost it, and you know, somebody stole all my money. I just want to show you how sin is.
Yes.
Now, because that person has lied and that person has lost all the money gambling, does that mean that God writes them off?
No.
It means that person could repent of their sins and get back to God. As a matter of fact, the type of repentance that is needed, the Bible says in 2 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 10, that God is sorrow. There's got to be a type of sorrow that a person comes over the person that causes them to repent of that sin that forces them not to go back to falsehood. That means that the things I used to do, I find myself no longer. I'm not doing them because the Bible said so, but there is no desire.
Amen.
There is no wanting. And I don't want to do that. You know, I've been shacking up with this sister for 5 years. You know, we got these babies. You know, said, talk to me. Said, man, yes, man. Let's go down the street. Go to McDonald's and buy a ring or something. Let's put it on a finger. Let's just have a little ceremony. I can't live like this no more. That's right, because the desire to shackle has gone. Listen to me. When you are delivered from something, I know what I'm talking about. When you're delivered, that desire to do that has changed. Because it's a godly soul that produces that inside of you. So when we see someone continue in a lifestyle of sin, continue practicing, then we know definitely that person still needs to go back to the cross. Because there is no desire for change. There is another type of sorrow that Paul speaks about there to the church in Corinth. He says there is a worldly sorrow. It's a sorrow that you've been caught in your action. So I've been caught at Foxborough. You know, my wife and I took a trip one time. We took a boat ride somewhere in the Caribbean. And while we were going, we met some people at the airport. And you know, my wife said to me, "Oh, well then," and they said, "Somebody sent." I said, Yep. Let's get together." So we meet them. We gathered. I mean, just hung up with them and just had a good time with them. And while we're there, my wife looked at me and says, "We ain't gonna see them again." And I said, "What do you mean? They're saints. They are brothers and sisters." She says, "Let me to see them again." So of course, here we are on the cruise, and we're going down the Caribbean islands, and I'm saying, "Wait a minute, honey,